already writing down things on your paper, so don't worry, you will get this. It's ready for you. And it's also available online. You've probably seen it, but sometimes it's also nice just to have it on your fingers and be able to browse through it. So we have it ready. This is lessons from last year, because last year we didn't print it for the participants because we want to be green and friendly, not putting out too many papers, but people apparently still want to have it on their hands. So we have it for you. Okay, so this nice book will be in your hands soon, so you don't have to take notes of everything. Now, let's start with the first module. Now, here, remember Donnie was saying that this is divided into several different. So here, the keyword is context, contextualizing. Yeah, that's what we will discuss about. And here we have a specific learning objective for the next three sessions, which is to increase your understanding and knowledge of issues related to IR and the planned interventions and ethical considerations. So in practical terms, what we expect you to be able to achieve by the end of this upcoming three sessions is these three things. First, we hope that by the end of this session, you would be able to analyze the context in which IR projects are conducted, number one. Number two, we hope that you would be able to understand and appreciate the context relevant to the proposed planned intervention. And number three, we hope that you would be able to describe the ethical principles and dilemmas related to IR. So here we highlight three key concepts: context, interventions, ethical principles. Okay? So those are the three things we will discuss. I will discuss with you regarding context, and then Ayat will come back later after the coffee break to discuss about the interventions. And then after lunch break, Donnie will come in and discuss about the ethical principles and dilemmas. Okay? So these are the big three key concepts that we will discuss for the next three sessions. Why do we need to understand the context in which we will be implementing our project? Does anybody have any ideas, contribution you would like to share regarding this question? Why do we actually need to think about context? It's hard enough to think about research on intervention. Why do we need to bother to think about context? Anybody have any insights on this, wants to contribute? Why it's so important to think about context? Yes?
Very important issue, particularly for the...
A bit closer to the mic.
Oh, yes, sure. That's a very important particular issue, because if we don't know the context of the research which we are going to implement in the field, that will not make the outcomes.
Okay.
Or proper guidance for the policymakers.
Okay.
So that's very important, the relevant activities through the other sources to know the basic context, then we can start. So this is why for the implementation research, it's very important to know exact context of the issue.
So the context will influence the outcome. Yeah. So it will interact with the intervention, it will influence the outcome. Okay. Other thoughts, other contributions? Why do we need to speak of context? Yes.
Why we need the context? Because before we conduct the activity, example by do the intervention, we need to know by ourselves how we will do the process that we will do. If we don't understand about about the context, how can we do for how can we find the strategy? How can we do anything for intervention?
Okay.
This is my idea.
So in order to prepare the strategy, you need to understand the context. Otherwise, you would not have an idea how you would actually strategize to implement the intervention. Okay? Other ideas? And why is this important? Other thoughts? Besides, you have something, Dorothy? Yeah?
Context being extremely important. One, because there are many things out of our control in the field. Unlike, say, in a controlled environment where you do a drug trial and other things, where you can control many things. Here, it's much more to do with humans and people, and things. Many things are out of control. So to understand the context and to understand where and what fits in, I think it's extremely important.
Yeah. That's a very important note, that it's not under our control. Yeah. It's different if you do an RCT, if you do a clinical trials, where many things you try to put under your control, but in the real world, most of the things you cannot control. Yeah? And these are what we call the context. These are what we need at least to understand and know so that we can actually anticipate it instead of but not actually controlling it, but be able to work within a particular context. Okay, so I think you've touched on most of the key points. And if you later look at the toolkit, they have this nice diagram, which I kind of like because it's really highlight why context is important. So here they try to say that, for example, if you have a very efficacious tool, say you have a new drug, which is highly efficacious as demonstrated by an RCT, you have a new TB drug, which is really good, and theoretically, if you apply it all over the world, then TB prevalence would go down, theoretically, because it's highly efficacious. But here you see that that's not necessarily the case, because it depends on several issues. It depends, for example, how accessible is the new drugs. Perhaps because it's new, it would only be available on the tertiary hospitals in the big cities. So it's not going to be accessible by most of the population who actually needs this new drug. So then you already go down in terms of your effectiveness. Second layer, perhaps even on those tertiary hospitals in the big cities, not all of the lung specialists are happy with the drugs. Maybe they are not so confident, maybe they question the side effects, the adverse effects which are coming with the drugs, so they still prefer to use the old drug rather than new drug. So even though they are patient coming, they don't give them the new drug, they give them the old drug. That goes down again. Third layer, even perhaps if the doctor, the lung specialist prescribed the new drugs, perhaps the patient is not going to be taking the drug as they should be, because still this is going to take you 6 to 9 months. And most of the patients, when they feel better already, they already stop taking the drugs. So perhaps after 3 months, they already stop taking the drugs. That goes down again. So here you see the level of effectiveness just keeps going down because of all of this. And all of this are context related. How accessible is your drug is related to your health system, related to your logistic, your supply chain. That determines how accessible is your drug. Related also to whether this is an expensive drug, whether you have to pay for it, whether it's free, those are health system issues. Provider compliance, that's related to the people, the clinicians who are actually delivering it. To what extent they have confidence on these drugs, that's also context. Patient, they're the one who's actually taking it. That also influences it. So here, you see very nicely how what we hope in the beginning to be a very promising tool, but at the end, it doesn't deliver. It doesn't deliver because of all of this in-betweens, which in the end, this is what you see in the field, the effectiveness, which is different from the efficacy. Yeah? Efficacy is what you get out of a control setting. Efficacy is what is demonstrated if you do an RCT. A clinical trial, you get an efficacy figure. But that's not effectiveness figure. Effectiveness is what you get under a field condition, under a routine condition. And that's what you see, that there's a difference between efficacy and effectiveness. Yes?
Actually, as you mentioned, like provider compliance, that we collect data particularly for the RCTs or for the RCT intervention.
Yeah.
If we collect the provider compliance, so how do we analyze this, particularly for the implementation research? Is there any system to analyze this?
Okay, this later we will go into how you measure variables, for example, for compliance, yeah? But these kinds of things you control under an RCT setting because you are putting things in place to make sure they are actually compliant in an RCT settings. In a routine setting, you don't put these things in place, not everything, because you don't have all the resources. Under RCT setting, you have all the resources that you can make sure that these guys, they actually do as they are supposed to do. But under non-RCT, then that's not the case. Now, how will we measure it? That's another session, we're not going to discuss it here, but all of this, yes, there will be a measurement issue. You have issue of how do you measure provider compliance, you'll have issue of how you measure adherence, you'll have issues of how you measure accessibility. All of this have measurement issues later on, correct? So not just the provider compliance, but all of this later on, then the question is, okay, how do you measure it credibly? And then afterward, how do you actually increase it? How do you improve it? What are the strategies you can put in place to increase provider compliance? What are strategies you need to put in place to increase patient adherence? That's implementation research. So you measure where are your bottlenecks. For example, perhaps your bottleneck is an accessibility. Then you work on that. Then you measure accessibility and you try to think how do you improve accessibility. Perhaps accessibility is not an issue. You manage to distribute it widely, but then you have resistance from the clinicians. You measure the compliance and then you have to work out, okay, then how do you improve the compliance? Perhaps none of them are an issue, but it's on the patient side. The compliance rate is very low, the adherence is very low. You have to measure that and then you have to think how do you improve their adherence. Yeah? So all of this have measurement issues behind it, but that's the thing that we would like to discuss throughout this 4 days workshop. Once you've picked out in your particular projects, which are the actual implementations outcomes that you are working on, how do you measure it, and how you will work with it, okay? But thank you for bringing that up, okay? Yes?
I would like to ask for clarification whether the IR in doing IR, we need to know the context first, or what if we don't know the context and we would like to know whether the context influence the results of the implementation?
Yeah, okay. So, first of all, context is important and it's very unlikely that you don't know anything about the context. You, most of the time, you do have some ideas of the context. It's just that perhaps you don't know exactly how the context influence the intervention. That's part of the IR. That's part of what you are going to study. But to have a knowledge of also of the context. And that's why this is the first one. This is the first module. It's about context because it sets the stage for the intervention, for the implementations, and that's now what we will discuss now. If we say context, what do we mean by context? What are the most important things? Most of you actually have been working with context, but perhaps you don't approach it systematically, or you don't call it context. But all of these things which we try to put together later on, you will see is actually not new things. I mean, you've been thinking about this, but perhaps you're not approaching it systematically and calling it contextualizing. Here we call it contextualizing because we try to do it systematically to be able to document what are the contexts which are relevant to this. But we will do this together, okay? Anything else? Any other issues, questions? Okay, so here we all agree that context is important because here you see that context influence the outcome, effectiveness, and in different contexts, different intervention could give a different outcome, right? One drug could give a different outcome in another, in a different health system because of a different context, because perhaps the accessibility is different, the compliance is different, the adherence is different, so that will lead to a different outcome. So different contexts could lead to different outcomes. That's why we need to know the context and how it influences the interventions. And that's where in the next session we will discuss that. How does the context actually influence the interventions? But now we start with the context first. Yeah? So now we all say that context is important and all of us have been working in public health for many years, know that context is important, and you read many journals that say context matters. Yeah? But what do we actually mean by context? When we say context in public health, but what do we actually mean? What comes in your mind? What does this constitute? What are we talking about here when we say context? For example, what would be concrete things that come up in your mind when you say context? Sorry, could you use the mic?
It is challenge.
Challenge. Okay. Other things? What are aspects of context here? Okay, to put it more concrete, for example, if you're asked by WHO to implement an interventions in Latin America, in Brazil. None of you comes from there, right? What do you need to know about the context to be able to implement that successfully? sorry, the mic. The what?
So most of, first of all, we need to know the geographic location.
Geographic, okay.
Second, need to learn about the culture, about the locality, the local people.
Yeah.
And third is also about the health facility, the facilities. So okay. About the tertiary and the remote level.
Mm-hmm.
So okay. Which facility available in the tertiary level and also in the remote level hospitals.
Okay. So there you were talking about health system, and then you're talking about social, demographic, geographical factors, right? What other things that you want like to know? Yes.
I think it's also important to understand who are involved in the either implementing or who are the recipients of the implementation.
Yes.
Because we need to understand whether that is really a issue that they would like to address and whether that is a problem in itself for them or not.
Okay. So who are actually implementing it? Yeah.
And who are receiving
it? And who is receiving it? For example, the patient. What are the issues from their side? Tilak, you have something?
Yeah, I think political issue also important to implement any intervention.
Yeah.
The politics, we need support from the leader of this region.
Yeah. Okay, so politic also influence, that's also an important part of the context. Any other important aspect and important dimension which we haven't touched on? So we talk about social, demographic, geographical, health systems, implementers, recipient, politics. What else? Okay, so I think the big ones you've raised. Now, if you later go back to the toolkits, they classify, they categorize this context into four dimensions. So the first one is what Sohail was mentioning. So it's about the physical, socioeconomic, and cultural context. Physical, for example, here geographical, okay? And then health system, mentioned also, stakeholders, this include the one who is implementing or the ones receiving, and then also particularly the institutions, the organizations who are actually involved in the implementations, okay? So this is how they classify it within the toolkit, and this is what we will unpack one by one. So let's take a look first at this, yeah? The first one is about physical and demographic factors, and then socioeconomic status, cultural, and political factors. For the first one, Sohail mentioned, for example, geography. What else besides geography? What are physical factors which you think are important to know when you want to implement a particular intervention besides geography in physical terms? You want to add, Sohail?
Yeah. For the geographical location or the physical location, the most important is the, just like the example from my country, the under 5 child mortality rate. So we have the 6 division. So one of the division called Sylhet is the highest rate. So we need to know the actual region. So where that geographical location is the highest rate of the mortality rate.
Yeah, okay.
So this is important. Also the which types of facilities are available over there. So this is one. And also the cultural one, the cultural things, culture, socio-cultural economy. Maybe they have money, but they have some obligation by the religion or some of the socio-cultural things. So it's also important.
So physical, geographical, here you would also think of urban, rural. It will be different, no? Whether you implement a particular intervention in an urban setting, in a city, like here, or rural, which is 2 hours drive away. It's a totally different context already, yeah? You would also think of the infrastructure. How's the transportation, the distance, and so forth. Whether it's a mountainous area, or a valley, or river, that would also be different. A mountainous area, it's more challenging. Yeah? Whether it's forest, jungle, those are physical things that you need to know if you want to make a strategy for implementation, as you already mentioned. If you don't know this, you will make up something which is completely not suitable, because you didn't know that this was a mountainous area. You think this was a city, apparently they're implementing it in a mountainous area. So that's completely different. Demographic, like what Sohail mentioned, also you need to know the distribution of the disease, of the burden of disease, the epidemiology. where are the diseases concentrated, the prevalence and so forth. Yeah, and you need to know the population size. You need to know the demographic in terms of gender, male, female, also in terms of age group. Who are we aiming for here? Is this something for children? Is this something for adults? Is this something for older generations? That's going to be different. Yeah. So social, demographic, physical and demographic. And then socioeconomic status, culture. You mentioned about money, okay, rich and poor, poverty level, socioeconomic structures. That will also differentiate things in terms of accessibility, whether they have the resources to do it, to access the interventions. That will affect cultural. He mentioned also values. Perhaps they have the money, but they have values which are against that particular interventions. For example, if you talk about people who are campaigning for condoms, in many parts of Asia, which is very conservative, this is against the traditional religious values. No? So even though it's there, it's cheap, but people may be against it. So here, cultural values becomes an issue. Political factors, unfortunately, that's something which is important. Most of us doesn't like to deal with it, because most of us are technical people and politics is dirty business. I mean, that's what we like to think about. But unfortunately, health cannot be separated from politics, because health has a lot of interest around it. And if you have multiple interests, you have conflict of interest, you have politics. You cannot escape from politics. And whether you like it or not, you have to deal with this, that the politic will influence also the implementation of the interventions. Yeah? Okay? Is that clear? Anything to add in this, in terms of physical, demographic, socioeconomic? Any additions? Okay? Okay, good. So this is quite a huge dimensions. And if you try it, you will get a list from A to Z, of course. But the point is, of course, not to try to document everything, but to think of which are the most relevant for your interventions. To what extent, for example, economic is important for your intervention? To what extent demographic is important for your intervention? Just a checklist for you to remind you that don't forget to check whether this is important or not. If important, then you have to think about it. So it's not something which you have to go through everything, but just to, as a reminder of the key ones. Yeah? The next one which was brought out was about health system. So I think we all agree health system influence a lot. But what are actually the elements of health system? If we say health system in practical terms, what do we have to look into? What are the elements there of a health system? What are we talking about? What would you think about? If you want to know the health system in Brazil, what exactly do you want to know in practical terms? Anisha, yes?
The what? Who all are the healthcare providers? Okay. What are the health facilities available? Mm-hmm. The human resources for the health.
Yeah.
And of course, the patients also form the part of the health systems.
Mm-hmm.
And what is the, I would say, the finances or the budgeting of the health system, the health facilities, so all that would compromise, all that constitutes the system.
Okay, so we're talking about healthcare provider, health facilities, the patients, the budget, the financing, yeah? So all are important components of a health system. Others, other opinions, what do we mean by health system? To complement what she already say? About health system, anything to add? I think she covered most of the important elements. And just not to miss, it's always useful to refer to a particular health system model or framework. Usually they have these different elements. And you will see in your toolkits, one of the most commonly cited one is this one, which is the WHO system building blocks. Yeah. Which just give you a list of blocks for you not to miss when you think about health system. For example, here, she mentioned a lot at the service delivery level. Who are the providers, the health facilities, and so forth. And then you were also talking about the budget, the financing. That's part of the healthcare financing. Yeah, but there are also others, for example, the health workforce, the doctors, the nurses, the midwives, what are the situation there, the technologies, the medical product which are available there for the implementations, what are the information system which is there, the surveillance, monitoring, evaluations which is available, leadership, governance, that's also an important part of health system. So this, I think, is a useful starting point for you just to think of what needs to be considered when you think about a health system. It's not necessarily perfect. There was a review of health system framework a few years ago, and they say there's about over 30 different health system frameworks out there. So it could be confusing because each has its own strength and limitations, advantage, disadvantage. Yeah? For example, if you see here, you don't really see community. No? It's missing. It doesn't come out quite strongly. The patient, for example, where are they here? Then, okay, this is not perfect, but it has some advantage and disadvantage. And you can compare those different frameworks which are out there. I mean, pick a framework which you think are most useful for you, which clarifies the situations best, and pick the simplest one. Some of them are just confusing. They're very complicated frameworks out there. This is one of the simpler ones which are popular because people think it's quite simple and highlight some of the important issues, even though there are some elements there which are not there. Okay? But at least if you do this, you won't miss some of the critical ones, and you will get a good overview of what is the health system context in the place that you will implement your interventions. Okay? Any comments or questions up to here? You want to add something, Ayat? You look like you want to add something.
Exactly. Why are you all so quiet? I mean, Yudi here is giving you the key principles that we all know. So health systems, as he mentioned, and one of you rightly mentioned, are the health systems that we work in, and each and every one of you is from a certain country that has a different health system, and not only the Ministry of Health provides health care within your system, right? For example, in Sudan, the Ministry of Health is one of 20 plus public institutes that provides health services, being Army Medical Corps, being health insurance, social welfare, education, and so forth. So in implementation research, what we're trying to convey is that look out of the box, that it's not only where we are affiliated to. So if I'm affiliated to the Ministry of Health, then I will not only think of the Ministry of Health as the sole provider of health within my system. I'll also look at the informal health providers, which we have plenty of. They are part of the health system, but they informally provide health, being traditional healers, traditional birth attendants, caregivers, according to the context, according to the disease, according to the age, the specific age that we're dealing with. So it's all important to put in mind. Yes, the framework is great. We have them, as Yudi mentioned, to organize our thoughts, not to let us miss a certain block or a certain specific cohort within the health system, but it's also important, as he mentioned, to look at it within a dimension of patients and people-centered health system. So that's why we're here. We're here to see why this specific intervention is not working on the ground. How can we, as IR researchers, make it happen? And that's the first part, understanding the context, putting the pieces of the puzzle together. Okay, thank you, Ayat.
So just to highlight also that the first mistake that most people do is when they say health system, this is the structure of the Ministry of Health. That's it. And they think, okay, now we understand the health system because now you see the structure of the Ministry of Health. But as Ayat already highlighted, that actually doesn't represent the whole health system. In many parts of the world, the private sector is very large. In India, I know, in Bangladesh, in Indonesia, the private health sector is huge, and that's beyond the Ministry of Health structure. The informal, traditional sector, that's also quite large. And you don't see that on the structure of the Ministry of Health. So if you're trapped within just the structure of the Ministry of Health, you might not understand why things fail, because it doesn't actually represent the whole health system. Okay, so just to keep that in mind, don't be trapped with the formal official structure of the Ministry of Health, of the National Health System, okay? Okay, good. So that's the second part, health system. Now we go to the next part, which is stakeholder. Okay, so first that was the physical, socio-demographic, political, and so forth, and then we talk about health system, and now we talk about stakeholders. Now, to start with, what do we actually mean by stakeholders? Sorry?
Partners.
Partners.
To who provide the health services.
Okay, partners, part of stakeholders, others. Yes, Bindu, you have something? Yeah.
Anybody who has a stake in the, like either they are involved in the service provision or involved in providing the service or are getting affected by it, like for example, the community and the patients.
Okay, coming back to the name, anybody who has a stake, stakeholder, anybody who holds a stake. Okay, anything to add? Yeah, I think that was a nice way to put it. It's actually anybody who is affecting or being affected by your project. Yeah? And it could be positive, could be negative, could be a partner, meaning somebody who is positive, who is working for you. Could be somebody who's actually against you. He's a stakeholder who has something, a conflict of interest, who's resistance, but that's a stakeholder, somebody who has a stake. So it's not just people who are with you. You also have to think of people who are against you. And there are people out there who are against the things that we want to do. Yeah? So to open that up a bit, yeah? So we have to think quite broadly of what we mean by stakeholders. Yeah? So here we have to think of who are they in a broad term, yeah? Not just to the people who we work with, who are they, and why would we need to engage them? Even though there might be people who seems to be reluctant or resistance, you might be able to engage them. And then how can you actually engage them if you identify them as some stakeholder who needs to be engaged? How do you actually work with them? How do you engage them? That's another level. And the last one is, what role exactly should they play? For example, as a partner, that was what Sohail meant. That's one role, but there are other roles that stakeholders can play. So just to start with, just in the next 5 minutes, just discuss in your group on the first question, who are the key stakeholders in your particular IR project? Okay, so just discuss in your group and we'll come back and we'll see the list that you come up with. Eh? So just discuss in your group for your IR project, the one that you are working on, who are the key stakeholders? Just try to come up with the list in 5 minutes, okay? So just discuss it and we will discuss. We'll go around and check. Tilak, you can discuss with the Bangladesh colleague. Yeah. You could perhaps move your seats, it's a bit too far. Huh? You can bring it closer. As long as possible. Thank you.
Okay, time's up. So we will just go around the room and each group just report, okay, who are the stakeholders. And we, because of in interest of time, we don't want you to read 10, 20 stakeholders. Just tell us who are the top five most important stakeholders according to your group. You might have 10, but then pick which are the five most important ones. Yeah, so tell us what are the five most important stakeholders. Now, before you mention it, please mention also the project that you are doing so the others know the context that, okay, for this project, we think the key stakeholders are this. These are the top five. Okay, is that clear? Okay, so who wants to start? Bangladesh, yes, please. Tell us what your project is and who are the top five key stakeholders.
Thank you. So our title for the proposal is the designing a comprehensive dengue vector control guideline through community engagement and implementation research on paving ways for dengue elimination to support Dhaka North City Corporation, Bangladesh. So in this proposal, so we have some stakeholders. So we just categorize in two, who is the service provider and the service recipient. So service recipient is the city dwellers, so who lives in the Dhaka North City Corporation. So all of them are the service recipient. And the service provider, so in top five is mostly in Bangladesh. So our health service provided by in the government, they have four wings inside government. So one is the Minister of Health and Family Welfare. Number two is the local government and engineering department. And number three is the Ministry of Women and Child Welfare. Yeah, and another one is Ministry of Finance also. So this is the from government. And the number two, there's some NGOs working for the city dwellers to provide the health facilities. And obviously we are working for the city corporation. So city corporation is one of the most biggest stakeholder here. So another one is the policymakers also, and others is the academician who are doing some research. Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Soel. Next group, who wants to share? Yes, Cambodia.
From Cambodia, team has proposed one proposal for IR. There is a comparative assessment of IECBC intervention on providing knowledge of the multi-drug resistance in Cambodia amongst cross-border and internal mobile migrants. The stakeholder for this proposal, there one is internal mobile migrant, the people okay. move around in the country, okay. and the second is a cross-border. The people cross between Cambodia and Thai's border. And the third stakeholder, they are local authority. Their local authority is their chiefs of village, chief of health center, chief of commune, something like that. So they would like them to answer our structure questionnaire about the knowledge of the drug resistant, malaria anti-drug resistant in Cambodia along the Cambodia-Thai border.
Okay.
Is that all?
Okay. Thank you. Next, which group? Papua. Okay.
For us, our research is malaria cases in Jayapura district, with the topic why the trend remains high after implementation of all malaria intervention, and our stakeholders there. There is a local government. This including executive and legislative, and also health department, and public and private sectors. The second is an academia, because there we have a health institute who produce more local health worker there. That usually absorbed by each district there. And the third is journalists. This is also important to socialize and also engage all of the community there. And in the village level, There is a tribe leaders, community leaders, and also other partners, including UN agency there, and also other international or national agency.
Okay, thank you. The other two groups, which one? India? Yes, Bindu?
Our proposal is to increase the pediatric TB referrals using the implementation research, and for us the important stakeholders would be all the healthcare providers. That includes public sector providers as well as the private sector, and also the traditional healers. We also have this community level health workers who also play a very important role. Then the next comes the TB national level TB program staff and all the people who are associated with implementation of the national TB program. The third would be pharmacists, because we often see that patients go directly to the pharmacist, and they can also be very important in referral of pediatric TB cases. Fourth would be the community, and finally also involvement of the local governments to implement this program.
Okay, thank you. Last but not least.
Okay, for our team, the first is research center, or and then the local government from village and the city, and then the health professional from doctor, nurse, and other related professional, and then we need non-government organization, and then community leader.
Community leader. Okay. Okay. Thank you. So you've all already started to identify who are your stakeholders, and there are still a few more questions. I mean, this is something that you would work on later after this, yeah, but this is just to initiate. But after this, what we hope that you would also continue with the rest of the questions, because it's not just about knowing who they are, but at the end it's about how you will work with them. And that needs some thinking. Yeah? And also to think, who will you work with? Because you might have 20, 30 stakeholders, and you don't have the resources to work with all of them. You need to prioritize which stakeholder that you would spend time, energy on. Yeah? So this, the rest of the questions are needed for you to think through at the end, how are you going to work with them? Not just to know who they are, but actually at the end, how are we going to engage them, what role they will play, and so forth, okay? So that wraps up the third part of the first key concept here. Now we come to the fourth dimension, which is about institutional analysis. Now, among the stakeholders, you will find institutions. Institutions which maybe are important for implementing the interventions, okay? So here then we have to think of institutional analysis, because we need to know also to what extent or how these institutions will influence the outcome of our interventions, yeah? So this is beyond the stakeholders. So we are focusing on specific institutions which are of particular importance to the implementation of the interventions. You can think of which are the institutions which are actually important and critical for you to work with. And there you think of, why does we actually need them? Why do we actually need them for the interventions? And then also, how can you identify them, and what role can they play in the project? What particular role that you expect them to play in the project? Yeah? So this is some of the things that you consider in thinking of which are institutions particularly that you will be working closely with. And another thing here which is recommended to do in order for you to be able to understand or anticipate how they will influence the implementations is to do a SWOT analysis. Is everybody familiar with SWOT analysis? SWOT stands for strength, weaknesses, opportunity, threats. Okay, so you look at the particular institutions and you try to analyze what are their strengths, and you list them. And then what are their weaknesses, and you list them. What are the opportunities, this is the external of the institutions, and then what are the threats, yeah, which are there. So then you see to what extent the strength, weaknesses, opportunity, threat potentially influence the implementation of your interventions, okay? So that's what here is meant by doing an institutional analysis, yeah? Trying to identify institutions which you think are important for implementations and doing analysis to see how that they would be influencing this by doing this SWOT analysis, okay? Any questions for this last dimension, for institutional analysis? Is it clear? Okay, so if it's clear, then we've wrapped up the whole four dimensions. It's full on your head now, all four dimensions, and which means now you would be ready to tackle the next exercise, which is a short, brief exercise of reflections, okay? So what we want you to do in the next 15 minutes is look into these points and to start thinking in your group. So start with thinking, what are the socio-cultural political system in your project area? We were thinking in generic terms, yeah, in the discussion, but now we want you to think in your particular project, okay? And think of how is the health system structured, again, in your project area? Public, private, informal, formal, provincial, district, national, all of that which you think are important. And then think of how that structure would impact your project. The next one you already did, who are the stakeholders, so that's quite easy, you can skip that one. And then, but then you have to think of what are the specific knowledge and skills that each of the stakeholders brings to the research project. Not for all of them, but for the ones who you think are important. And then think of all of this, of all these five, and also to reflect on how will the consideration of these factors impact the planning of your IR project. Yeah? You have something to add, Ayat? No? Not at this point. Okay, later. Is this clear, these points? Yeah? So it's just something to discuss in your groups. Yeah? Just go through it in the next 15 minutes and we'll have a discussion around that to see how useful that is. But before we go further, we just realized that there are three people which we haven't really introduced because we were doing a group introductions. So we have two participants here from Solo. They will be joining, so here we have Ibu Arsita, they will be joining the Sriwijaya group, the Palembang group for the group discussions. And we have Ibu Khotijah who will be joining the Papua group. And we have Tilak also, he's from Bangladesh, he already joined the Bangladesh group. So these are additional participants which we have invited that we hope will also be benefiting from these trainings and perhaps also be taking part in the further dissemination of this training. So for this exercise, I would request the additional participants to already join the group so that they can already take part in discussion within the group, okay? So for the next 15 minutes, just discuss with your group these things, all these points, and then we'll have a round of discussions to wrap it up, okay? To discuss, I'm just gonna ask for a couple of group to volunteers to share whatever they have already on the discussions. Who would like to volunteer? Which group? This group, okay, Papua group, please. Please listen to what the Papua group has discussed.
So our research proposal is about malaria cases, why the trend remains high after implementation of all malaria control intervention. So based on our own discussion, for the first question, what are the socio-cultural and political system in our project area? First, particularly because in Papua, we already apply the centralization system. However, the focus depends on the highest local leader. So whatever the mayor, for example, say that it will be should be applied in all aspects. The second, regarding the political system, actually the pro-community regulation is available or is already taken place. However, the implementations still depend on the political interest or the political affiliation. Mm-hmm. The third depends on the, we thought the third factor is the literacy. Mm-hmm. We have the urban and rural area. Of course, in urban, the literacy is more higher, but in the rural area, is low, so it will affect their perception of illness. Mm-hmm. what they think about the illness and when they need to seek for the healthcare. And the other things is about the poverty. And then the next thing is three-quarters of the population in this district is in an urban area. However, this urban area is we consider as a transit area. So the mobilization of the population is quite high. The second question is about the health system structure. If you look at back again to the six building blocks of WHO, the first factor is leadership. Again, it's decentralization. So it depends what the mayor say. However, so far we find the head of the district health authority has a good leadership. The second about the financing for the malaria program is available, but not sufficient and it's not in a sustained way. Regarding the workforce, in terms of number is enough. However, it's not distributed equally between the urban and rural, mostly at the urban, and there is a high turnover of the staff. After we train some of the people, in a certain period of months, then it's turned over and moved to another area. Regarding the medical products and technology, in terms of malaria control intervention, it is bed nets, drug, laboratory facility is available. However, in terms of utilization, it's a question mark.
Okay.
Regarding information research, there has been a study going on, particularly for factor control, but regarding the data recording and reporting, still need to be improved. Service delivery is available. There has been a training available, screening, and then campaign of malaria control is available. That's so far our discussion.
That's good enough. Okay. So thank you for the Papua group. Now for the other group, in the interest of time, what I would like you to do is just to mention what are the most important things that you identified from this exercise which was useful for you, which you didn't think of before? What are the context factors that you managed to identify there? Not read all of them, but just mention, okay, what did you find out, what did you identify, which actually you think is important, but you didn't think of it before. Now you thought about it, okay? So starting from the Indian group, perhaps you can just mention, what did you find out? What did you get out of this exercise that was useful for you?
Yeah. So our research proposal was on improving the pediatric referral for TB cases. So we identified certain through this exercise of learning about the socio-political, cultural systems and health system structure, we were able to identify the strengths and weakness of the TB program in our country.
Okay.
So basically we found that positives being that TB is a priority disease in India. So the TB control program is very well structured in terms of the financing, in terms of human resources. However, there are certain negatives in that. First is that there is a lack of intersectoral coordination. So when we talk of pediatric cases, we also have to look at the education ministry. And so it's not just the Ministry of Health which should take care of the program. So it's very vertical approach which we follow. So there is lack of intersectoral coordination. And the focus is mainly on the adult TB interventions. So the pediatric focus is really lacking. So that is what we found through this exercise, that if we list out the positives and negatives, maybe that would help us strategize our research better.
Okay. So you managed the strength and weaknesses, you now have it. Okay, that's useful for further considerations. Bangladesh, just tell us what is the most important things that come out. That
yeah, maybe I can explain by the SWOT also. That's, maybe it will be the summarized for all. So for our project, so about the dengue elimination. So what is the standing point for our project is the, in our city, in Dhaka North City Corporation, there is different stakeholders working on it. So if it is possible to work all together, make it in one group, so it will be the good to eliminate the dengue. So this is the starting point. So the what is the weakness? So lack of coordination. So lack of inside the government, the lack of coordination. So that's like the Minister of Health blame. No, it's the city corporation task. City corporation blame to the local government. No, it's not for us. It goes to the local government. So just like this, the lack of coordination. This is the weakness among for the coordination among the stakeholders. And the opportunities is to, there is many opportunity to work on this. So because the dengue cases are mostly found in the slum area. So slum area is very easy to access for the researchers and also the policy makers, also the government also. So access to improve their hygiene system, also deliver the health information. So if you affect dengue fever or any other disease, you have to go there. You can get this type of facilities, blah, 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 just like this. So it is easy to deliver the messages. Mm-hmm. And the trend is we need the both bottom up and the top down approach to empower them.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. You both had coordination as a weakness, as an issue, yeah?
Yes.
So it's cross contacts here. Okay, Cambodia, just tell us what is the most important factor that you managed to get out of the exercise.
Most important for our study here regarding to this question that is for the culture political system. The social culture there is most of them are mobile migrants. We would like to know the movement of the people from non-endemic to endemic around the border. And most of them are the mobile migrants from non-endemic. They know less about the malaria prevention and seeking behavior regarding to treatment. And we know them, they are the people have the same religion, no any ethical or any people, the same population. Regarding to politics, it's the same. It means one country, one system, no any system regarding the political in the country. The health system structure is only one public health system in that area. In that area, they do not allow the private sector to have any service there because the malaria, anti-malaria drug resistance has occurred there, so we do not allow the private sector to open any clinic treated for malaria. The health system in park is easy to manage the guarding the people, mobile migrant people, because we have the one system and the health system is public, so easy to inform, easy to manage, easy to gathering the people to our study. The stakeholder agreements and that is internal mobile migrant cross-border or local authority and the community worker. Okay. The specific knowledge or skill that stakeholders bring to this research is malaria prevention, seeking behavior, and how to know the malaria symptom. And the last one, consider for this factor impact of the planning of the our project is to develop strategy for malaria elimination.
Okay.
Yes, that
one. The most challenging one was the social context, yeah? First one you highlight. Okay. Subhatra?
Our research is about filariasis in Banyu Asin. It is consists of swamp area. Moreover, 32 kilometers from Palembang, Banyu Asin is divided into land and water area. In water area, it's difficult to access because of the transportation. The social culture is about community leadership, health financing from government, health provider, health service delivery. Thank you.
Okay, so those are the most important contexts that you identified. Okay, thank you. So that's again just to trigger you to start doing this. Was this useful, this exercise? Yes, Bindu?
I don't know if we have time before the break. I just wanted to ask about the third question. So when we were discussing, I just wanted to know what exactly were you looking for in that question. We had a little bit of confusion, like how would health system impact our project? So do you have a specific criteria that you would like to assess when you're looking at health system impact on our project?
Yes, so here there is not much details, but Aya told me that you had tools behind this one for the new ones, no?
Yes.
So you can share perhaps?
Yes, we can share hopefully as within the coming days. And if I may, Yudi. Yes. How might the health system impact your project? Well, it depends on your respective project. So if it's a certain intervention, okay, are there actually, is it within the strategy of the health system? Is it within the priorities of the health system? That's why you'll find a better chance, not only for it to be funded, but for it to be implemented within the system itself. So what are you proposing within your respective IR projects? And is it within the national priorities? Are stakeholders actually calling for it? Is it within the international direction, universal health coverage, let's say? What type of eradication, what type of program? And then accordingly, you look at the health system, you look at what's happening in the ground and how your intervention or IR project fits in place.
So in short, but again, for all of this, there are tools which are out there that we are trying to compile, and it will be available for you. For example, for stakeholder analysis, there are tools for that also. So for the updated version, it will be there. You will get the links to the tools, so that it's much more concrete, much more practical for you how to do it step by step, okay? Okay, so that's the end of before the timekeeper stopped me, so I stop now. So that's the end of this first session, which is on context. And next, we will discuss with Ayat regarding the interventions, how the context influenced the interventions. But before that, we'll go for a coffee break. Yeah, the coffee break is outside here, just very nearby. But please come back within 15, 20 minutes, because we would like to take a group selfie, a group picture of all of you while the makeup is still fresh. Because the later we go, you look different, all of us look different while you're still fresh. So after your coffee break, please come back a bit early, 15, 20 minutes. We will set it up here, and we'll take your pictures together. Okay? So enjoy your coffee break, take a break, but please come back in 15 minutes. And you can go to the dressing room if you like, dress up a bit. We'll see you in 15 minutes. Okay?